يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة روحي وأرواح العالمين لك الفداء وأقل الفداء يا ليتنا ثم يا ليتنا كنا معكم فنفوز فوزا عظيما. بر محمد وآل محمد صلوات. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. الحمد لله على نعمة الإسلام وكفى بها نعمة. الحمد لله على منة الولاية وكفى بها منة. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا النبي المؤيد والرسول المسدد والمصطفى الأمجد والمحمود الأحمد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد، اللهم صل وسلم بارك على سيدنا محمد صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين سفن النجاة الأعلام. من ركب سفينتهم نجا ومن تخلف عنها هلك وغرق. ثم أما بعد، respected elders, brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Just to recap from yesterday, as you know, we are still in the same topic, which is the practical love of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhim ajma'in, based on the ayah that I recited on the first night, قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى. For those who have not been with us for the past two nights, basically, we've arrived at a hadith which I recited yesterday by none other than the Imam himself, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayh. If you remember, when he was speaking to Aban ibn Taghlub, and he says to Aban ibn Taghlub, Ya Aban, man ahabbana kana minna. The one who loves us, of course, as we will see shortly or momentarily, the Imam is not talking about me lip service love, as I've been explaining for the past 2 days. When I speak about love in this particular context, I'm always referring to practical love. Love that can be put into action. He says, Ya Aban, man ahabbana kana minna. And the Imam repeated this statement 3 times. And then I gave the explanation as to how this can be possible. Because as you know, Aban was perplexed by this hadith. How is it possible that I love someone and then I end up being part of him? I end up being part of him, right? Just like if you remember in the ziyarah of Arba'een, when we speak about Jabir. Remember the ziyarah of Jabir? When he comes and Al-Awfi, his student, is with him. He says, by God, Jabir says, by God, they have not taken a step or mounted a hill or gone down a hill, except that we were with them, right? Awfi says, Jabir, have you gone insane? We have not even lifted a sword, nor did we hold a dagger to fight with Hussein and his companions. How is it then you're claiming that you were part of them? He said, because I heard my beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, "Man ahabba qawman hushira ma'ahum." The one that loves a group of people in a practical sense, by holding their values and remaining faithful to their teachings, he shall be resurrected with them on the day of judgment. Right? It all leads up to one concept: to put their teachings and values into practice. So, and then the Imam leads him to the interpretation by Prophet Ibrahim in Surah Ibrahim, verse 36, where Ibrahim says, "Man tabi'ani fakana fa'innahu minni." Whoever follows me, then he is part of me, or he becomes me in particular. So so Hussein salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi explains to Aban ibn Taghlub the real concept of what it means to be a true follower of Ahlul Bayt salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhim ajma'in. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Surely, as we've been saying, that when Ahlul Bayt salawatullahi wa salamu alayhim ajma'in, or Imam Hussein in particular in this instance, is talking about love, he's not talking, again, I re-emphasize, about lip service or simply statements of love. For example, and please read me in context. Whenever I speak about an example, try to read me in context, because that example I'm giving may with some people be misunderstood. Someone does not pray, but he cries for Hussein, right? What do we call that? Do we call it practical love or emotional love? Emotional love, right? This is love based on emotion. Is it a bad kind of love? No, it's not. It's not. Why it's not? Because it may lead him one day to what? To practical love, right? So someone comes to the majlis of Abi Abdullah, for example, you know, and he doesn't pray, he doesn't fast. Do we shun him away? Do we say, don't come to the doors of Abi Abdullah, salawatullah wa salamu alayh? No, look at the teachings of his prophet, his grandfather, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. A young boy comes into the mosque of the prophet, and people know that this young person does things that are not in conformity with the religion of Islam. But he comes to prayer, right? So some of the companions of the prophet complains to the prophet. They said, Ya Rasulullah, we don't see you saying anything to this young man. Though this young man does 1, 2, 3, you know those pseudo maraji' taqleed that are among some communities, you know, that they are at the forefront in digging holes into people. You know, they just want to say something regardless whether it's true or not sometimes. And even if it's true sometimes, who has invited you to speak out? No? Who has asked you to come and give the portfolio and the history of that person? If you know something about your brother, either go to him and tell him in private or conceal it. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Man satara musliman satarahu Allah yawm al-qiyamah." The one who covers and conceals and hides the shortcomings of his brother in this world, Allah shall cover and conceal his shortcomings in the day of judgment. You know, unless this person openly does things. Well, if it's openly, you don't need to say anything about it, right? Then it's open. But if you know something yourself about someone, don't go and disclose it, right? Because then it is what? It is ghibah, right? And if he doesn't do it and you say it, then it is what? It's worse. It's buhtan. And buhtan is what? Is slander. Slander. The Prophet ﷺ said, to say something about your brother that he does, but he does it in secret, it's ghiba. But to fabricate something about your brother that he does not do it, then it is slander. Which what we call in modern today language, character assassination. Right? To character assassinate someone because you have some sort of a vendetta with him, or you don't like him, or there is some, you know, bad blood between you and him, so you fabricate a particular issue. That goes contrary to the teachings of Ahlul Bayt salawatullah wa salamu alayhim ajma'in. So superficially, outwardly, we call that love for Hussein, that this person comes, he does not pray, but he cries for Hussein. Let me go back to the story of that young man. So the Prophet says to them, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? I call Jibreel and a battalion of Malaika with AK-47, stand at the door and tell him, you're not allowed to come in. What do you want me to do? You know, they said, Ya Rasulullah, what do you think is the best solution? The Prophet says, leave him. Perchance one day his prayer will prevent him from haram. Allahu Akbar. Leave him. Perchance one day this prayer that he's observing will prevent him from the haram he's doing. Similarly is the case someone that comes for Hussein salawatullahi wa salamu alayh, the majalis of Abi Abdullah salawatullahi wa salamu alayh. You know, as I will read momentarily, there is a hadith that I don't think it has been mentioned before. Based on that hadith, we can infer that Imam Hussein has been given a certain blessing by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that those that love him will one day take a U-turn and be those followers that he anticipates them to be. Salawatullah wa salam alayh. So don't give up. I always say to my youth, if you don't pray, if you don't fast, if you don't do things, or you think you are praying and you are fasting, but your spirituality is not progressing, do not ever think one day of giving up on what you're doing. Don't. One day it will come to you. The realization of the benefit of this prayer, or this particular act of charity, or this particular act of goodness, or this fasting, or this hajj, or this ziyarah, or this act of goodness, it will come to change your life. But giving it up altogether, meaning you have sealed the deal on yourself, that there is no going back, right? So if you don't go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where are you going to end up? In whose hand you're going to end up? Who are you then inviting into your own premise if you've closed all the doors between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No, communicate to the last minute with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and don't despair. Because Allah compared giving up on Allah, that act of giving up on Allah amounts to shirk. Amounts to shirk. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَا يَيْأَسْ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. No one becomes, you know, or reaches a level of being in a state of desperation. No one arrives at a state of desperation with Allah except the non-believers, because they've given up, right? And a mu'min does not give up. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, a mu'min should not give up. A Muslim should not ever turn his back on Allah. No matter how much you pray and the answer does not come, it doesn't mean you've been abandoned. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come to you in different ways and in different means to save you at a time when you least expect it to be what? Saved. Right? When you are least expecting to be saved. So carry on. March on and do not give up, no matter what the situation is. Secondly, logically, is there a chance based on probability that one day you will take a recourse to Allah after you've tried everything? There is, right? Even logically, mathematically, there is a 50-50 chance, right or wrong, based on probability. That's what they taught us in schools, right? Take a chance at a number. You either have 50 chance of being right or 50 chance of being wrong, right? Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the same token, says don't give up. Why? Because if you do, there are consequences and repercussion. Okay. Let's say a youth gives up prayer at 15. He starts at 15, gives it up at 18, right? And then he decides that I'm not going to pray anymore. From 18 to 36 or to 40, how many years are these? From 18 to 40. 22, right? 22. 22 at 40, he decides to pray. What is the first thing he has to do? What is the first thing? Pay it back, right? Why? Pay it back. If you had continued praying from 18 to 42, even if this prayer did nothing to you, at least you didn't have to pay it back. Right or wrong? At least look at it from that positiveness. Right? At least you don't have to pay it back. Imagine paying back 18 years of prayer. Right? And then look at it financially. Because there are people who always calculate things by money. All right? This money is going to come out of your what? Out of your estate when you die to get someone to do the prayers on your behalf. Here goes your inheritance part, bro. Right? here goes your share in inheritance, right? So if you see someone in your family members, especially dad, God forbid that, he doesn't pray, make sure he prays because the estate is gonna get less, right? It's gonna, if you, inshallah, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. For the love of Al-Qa'im min Ali Muhammad, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, I ask you to come forward because brothers can't find a place to sit. So please kindly move forward with the loudest salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. May Allah reward you. Again, sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Having said this, the Imam again comes to emphasize in regard to that particular love. He says, yes, the one that comes to my majlis and he cries for me, but he doesn't observe the tenets that I fought and died for, okay, cannot be ascribed the title of a true practical lover of Hussein. He is an emotional lover of Hussein, but he is not a practical lover of Hussein. Why I say this? Look at the examples in Karbala, brothers and sisters. One of the companions of the Prophet comes to him in the midst of the battle, right? Or as the battle around to begin. Or according to some riwayat, the battle has already started, right? He says, As-salat, ya ibn Rasulillah. Ajib. The Imam looks at him, he said, Dhakarta as-salah. You remembered salah? What does he say to him? He doesn't say, Jazakallah khair for reminding us. Because he's the Imam, Ma'soom, he knows it's time for salah. You know what he says to this companion? He says, Ja'alakallah min al-musallin. May Allah make you always committed to your prayer. Or among those who always observe their prayers. This is practical love. That in the midst of challenge, you do not give up on the tenets of Islam. Because it doesn't make sense, brothers and sisters, that Imam sacrifices everything he had, including himself, so that he keeps the tenets of Islam intact, and I come and I be the cause of its sacrilege. And then I claim to be a follower of Imam. It doesn't add up. Okay? So the Imam, salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, in his definition of what a true practical love means, it means total submission to what the Imam says. Total submission. You know, we always have examples from Karbala that are incredible. You know, on the night of Tasu'a, the Imam gathered all his companions, right or wrong, put them in a marquee like this, right, and turns the candles off. And he says to them, Inna hadha al-layl fattakhidhuhu jamala. This is the night, take it as a ride. So he's using a metaphor. He's saying, this night is like a camel. Ride this camel and leave. If the Imam had said, you must leave, it becomes what? A command. It comes as a command. Then they have no right to stay. Right? But he wants to do what? He wants to iqama of hujja on them. Right? He said, this is the night. Take it as a camel and leave. And if you do, antum fi hil. If you do leave, I have no qualms with you. You will not be judged for that decision on the day of judgment. Look at practical love now. They begin to weep. Right? They begin to weep that they could not even fathom in the wildest of their imagination that they would actually be given such an option. And what was the reply to the Imam after he turns on the candle again and they are all sitting there weeping? They said, how can we face your grandfather and mother on the day of judgment? Yabna Rasulillah. But you know what? You know, by making that decision, it's not like just sitting on a couch with a remote control and flicking channels. Because in doing that, there is no consequences. But in sitting there and deciding not to leave, it means what? Your ultimate shahada. Goodbye, there is no return. There is no return. In fact, it is stated further that after that incident, the Imam shows his companions, each and every one of them, where they're going to die or not. Do we have this riwayat or not? Sahih riwayat we have that the Imam shows everyone Abbas, Ibn Shabib, Muslim Ibn Awsaja, Zuhair Ibn Al-Qain. You know, every one of them, he says, you will die here, you will die here, you will die here, you will die there. As we will come to know also on the day of Al-Qasim Ibn Al-Hasan, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, he did not mention anything about him. So he becomes worried. Allahu Akbar. Someone gets worried for not being told you're gonna die. People will get worried if you tell them you're not gonna live. Not if you're not gonna die, right? Normally by human instinct, if you tell someone you're not gonna live, you get worried. But if someone you're telling him, I don't know where you're gonna die, he gets worried for not being told you're gonna die. That's another level of faith. That's another level of iman. So Al-Qasim come to the Imam. He says, Ya Mawlai, I haven't heard you mentioning my name. So, لم يبلغ الحلم Al-Qasim. It says he has not yet reached what? The age of maturity. But look at his intellect. Comes and sits with his uncle. He says, oh uncle, you haven't mentioned my name. So Imam Hussein wants to test his faith. He knows who Al-Qasim ibn al-Hasan is. But that we can learn from that particular, you know, conversation or discussion. He said, oh Qasim, how do you view death? You know, imagine having this conversation with your 14 at home. You will sleep in the garage, I guarantee you. The wife will not let it pass. What are you doing to the child? Why this negativeness? Well, Habibi, not everything is negative in the case of death, by the way. Okay? Having such discussion, it doesn't mean ending of life. Having that discussion is broadening the spectrum of our kids, right? So that they know how to live in this life as if they're gonna live forever, and how to prepare for the akhirah as if they're gonna live die tomorrow. The hadith of Imam Ali: عش في دنياك كأنك تعيش أبدا وعمل لآخرتك كأنك تموت غدا. Right? Live in this world as if plan, you know, have ambitions, have morals, have, you know, whatever in your life as if you're gonna live forever. But don't be absent-minded of akhirah. Prepare for that akhirah also as if you're gonna depart tomorrow. Balance. Religion is all about what? Balance and moderation. So Al-Qasim looks at his uncle Imam al-Hussein, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. He says, are you referring to death in you? In you? Yani in your cause? So that Islam can remain? So that we can defend you and defend your integrity and defend your life, and we go? He says, yes, Yabna. He said, yes. That's what I'm referring to. Death for the sake of protecting and keeping Islam intact, the one that your grandfather worked for all his life. He said, in that case, death is better and sweeter than honey. Sweeter than honey. Then he says, then this is your place of death. This is where you're gonna die. This is where your shahada is gonna end up, you know? After that, see, the Imam is very particular. When you want to test someone, you don't test him by giving him privileges, no. You test him first by putting him on the spot, right? Then you will give him the glad tidings. The riwayah then says, after he showed them where they're gonna die, he showed them where there are places in Jannah. Their levels, right? Now you tell me, by God's name, who's gonna leave Hussein after that? Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Who will leave him? This is the kind of iman we want to have. This is the kind of iman we want to accrue when we come to the majalis of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. To be true, practical followers in the spiritual sense. This is the definition of practical love. Our spirituality should be Husseini. What does that mean? Our spirituality should be Husseini. That I should build my spirituality to such a degree that if the moment comes to give everything for the sake of Hussein, I will let everything go so that Hussein and the message of Hussein remains alive. And this can be represented by who? By the coming of Al-Hujjah, right? Ibn al-Hasan, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. You know? Money can't buy everything, brothers and sisters. Wallah, wallah, money can't buy you happiness or buy you stature or buy you a legacy or buy you good name or whatever. Yes, money is a mean to something, but it is not the goal, right? It's like, you know, I'm reminded by a group of people who are so much into money, so much infatuated into money. Money to them is everything. So they decided that if the Imam comes one day, don't laugh. If the Imam comes one day, they're going to have a meeting with him. And they tell him, look, Imam, we people don't know how to fight. So what else we'll do? We'll finance your campaign. Ajeeb. Well, no, you go fight, Habibi. Huh? We'll finance your campaign. What sort of talk is this? We finance your campaign? You think the Imam wants your money? The Imam wants your presence. Right? He wants you to be there that when he says, rise, it means what? Means rise, right? Drop everything and be there for your faith and your iman and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Build on your spirituality. Don't let it be taken away from you and hijacked by the temptations of Satan. No, when Satan comes to you, he says, Habibi, your tricks are old, right? Your tricks are old, right? You cannot buy my spirit on the basis of your temptations. But this does not come by talk. It has to be put into practice that when the temptation comes to you, like Imam Ali, you have now the rein of decision in your hand, right? You have the rein of decision. Like when you ride a horse and you take the rein of that horse, right? Why is that rein in your hand? So that you control the horse or the horse controls you? You control the horse, right? So the reign of decision should be in your hand, right? When that challenge comes, you steer it in the right direction. Inna hadaynahu sabil, imma shakiran wa imma kafura. Wa inna hadaynahu najdain. We've shown man both ways. He's either grateful or he is ungrateful. So the reign of decision is in your hand. Another explanation of practical love is the intellectual one. I should use my intellect on the basis of what? On the basis of my religion dictates, not on the basis of what my self-interest dictates, if it violates the tenets of my religion. Intellectually, we get challenged, right? We get challenged, especially in today's world. I don't want to go into details. You know exactly the biggest challenge we are facing as a community today, right? In terms of certain part of life. Intellectually, do not be the one that justifies a certain action when you know that this action violates the Quran and the teachings of Islam, right? Don't start playing intellect. No, let your intellect submissive to the tenets of Islam, right? And use it in the advancement of the tenets of Islam and the teaching of Islam, not into bringing Islam and its tenet into disrepute. On the basis of what? On the basis of what? Everyone is doing it. Everyone is doing it. For God's sake, is that a logical interpretation of action? If you are an intelligent human being, as we claim to be, and Allah has given us that intelligence, is it suffice intellectually to say that it is okay to comply because everyone else is doing it? But you know what? Allah says, أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Most of them don't know. أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ. Right? Most of them are ungrateful. أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَشْكُرُونَ. Most of them, they do not give thanks to Allah. So the majority that Allah is speaking about are intelligent or not intelligent. Yani they have a brain or they don't. They do. But majority does not indicate righthood, right or wrong. Does majority indicate righthood? Does majority gives right to an action being right? No, it doesn't. What gives rise to a decision being right is if it conforms with what Allah wants, right? Otherwise, look at the khilafah of Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. I say the majority of Muslims decided to give oath of allegiance to someone, no problem, I respect that. Okay, but does that action indicate righthood? Does it make it right? It does not. Not necessarily it makes it right. Yeah, if you want to believe in it, fine. I'm not going to put you down, right? That's your belief system. But to tell me that because the majority decided, it makes it right, yes, it does. When it conforms to the Book of Allah. When it conforms with the teachings of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. But if it doesn't, if the whole world gathers in one alley, look at the hadith of the Prophet. He says to Ammar, Ya Ammar, لو أن الدنيا اجتمعت, if the entire world gathered together and they took one alleyway and Ali ibn Abi Talib took another way, make sure, O Ammar, you will be in the way that Ali is in. If the whole world is on one side, doesn't indicate truth. Why? Because Ali umma al-Quran wal-Quran umma Ali, right? So all of a sudden we gotta say, but the majority are going sideways, so Ali can't be right. Is that logical? It's not logical. Huh? Although it may sound easier, right? More convenient, right? To conform, but that's the challenge. The challenge is not to conform. You know, someone told me one day, he said, Sheikh, why do you always say from your minbar? And I used to repeat this statement a lot, by the way. Now I've stopped for some reason. I don't know what, but I should use it again. He says, why do you tell your community you should be odd and weed? I said, yeah, I want my community to be odd and weed. He said, how so? I said, we are odd by not conforming. And we are weed by not being what? Accepting to conform. So I'd rather be weed towards Jannah than to conform towards hellfire. Right? So be odd. Be odd in what way? Not for the sake of just being different. No, be odd on the basis of your akhlaq. Yeah, everyone wants to swear? Don't swear. I'm the odd one out. And I'm happy. Right? I'm happy. Everyone is looking at the blondes and the brunette when they stop at the traffic light. I turn my face away. That's odd. I want to be odd. I want to be odd. Why should I conform? Right? And then say, but the Prophet said, the first glance is for you. So how long is that glance going to last? The entire duration of the traffic light? You know? The entire duration? Just when someone sitting on the traffic light with a tasbih on his hand and he's saying, Subhanallah, Subhanallah, Subhanallah. A blonde comes and says, Astaghfirullah, Astaghfirullah, Astaghfirullah. Ajib. Right? Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Huh? It's self-training, brothers and sisters. It's absolute self-training in order to be that odd. But odd in goodness. That's the meaning of being odd. Weed or qui in being someone that holds to his principles. People lie. I don't want to lie. Right? I don't want to lie. I want to be the odd one out. Great. Because you are holding to your tenets of religion. You are becoming what we call the beauty spot on a face of a beautiful human being's face, right? And that's a hadith by the Prophet. He said, be that mole. You know that nice beauty spot that Cindy Crawford used to have when I'm old, by the way, old school. I don't know who has this. But when she came out, she was the most famous with that beauty spot. Rasulullah says, be that beauty spot on the face of a human being. Meaning, be recognizable. But recognizable on what? On the basis of your akhlaq. On the basis of your principles. Be different. So when people look at you, says, why are you different? And this is the opportunity. Right? Kunu lana du'atan samitin. Advocate our cause, Imam al-Rida, by being silent. قالوا كيف يا ابن رسول الله? How do we advance your cause by being silent? He said, by learning our teaching and then putting it into practice. People will observe and they know you are different. They know you are different. You go to work and you don't cheat. You don't steal. You don't take A4 papers because they spare of them. Home, you take reels of them, you know. He says, it's okay, alhamdulillah, the government has plenty. So if I take one or two, it's okay. Everyone does it. Again, the same concept. Everyone does it. Your boss comes and says, you haven't taken any reels of A4 paper? He says, yeah, because I am Amin. What does that mean? He says, Wallah, when my prophet came to Arabia in 600 and whatever, 33 or whatever, you know, the people who were against him and opposing him called him the trustworthy. Why they called him the trustworthy? I'll tell you a story why they called him the trustworthy. When the prophet decided to migrate, all the trusts of the non-believers were not with Abu Sufyan. They were put at the prophet's house. You know why? Do you know why? Because those leaders of Mecca did not even trust one another. So Abu Jahl would not trust Abu Sufyan. And Abu Sufyan does not trust Abu Jahl. Or Abu Jahl does not trust Utbah. Or Utbah does not trust Al-Walid. So where do they put their gold and silver? They put it with someone they don't believe in. Ajib, wallah, ajib. That's a miracle in itself. They go take their money and leave it with the Prophet. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, you are Amin. You are Amin. I don't believe in you. You know, imagine your British white neighbor says, you know what? I respect you as a neighbor. You're a Muslim, I know. But I don't want to follow your faith. But you know what? I trust you so much that I'm going on a holiday. Can you keep this car for me? How do you think he arrives at that? Through your principles, right? Just like those Meccans. So the Prophet decides to migrate. The first crook among all these leaders is Abu Jahl. He comes to the Haram, Mecca. And he declares with the loudest of his voices, that person that you call trustworthy has left and he has taken all your trust with him. He thought that the Prophet has taken, you know, it's like they call it collateral damage. You are kicking me out, so I might as well take your money, right? Well, you started it. So he leaves the Prophet. Immediately, as Abu Jahl comes and declares this statement, Imam Ali comes from the opposite side. He says, whosoever has left the trust with Muhammad, let him come and claim it from me as his agent. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Right. This is practical love. This is practical Islam, right? The Prophet, despite the fact that by Geneva Convention law, I'm saying, and I'm responsible for what I'm saying. By Geneva Convention law, the Prophet had the right to take all this money because they took it out from him first, right? He had the right over this money, but there is a bigger right, and that's the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who's watching over him. He says, no, I have a responsibility. These people trusted me. I don't betray the trust. So he leaves everything. And this is why Mufassirin say, the reason why Rasulullah left Amirul Mu'mineen behind him were for two or three main purposes. Number one, to sleep in his place. Number two, to return all the trust. And number three, to bring all the Fawatim from Mecca to Medina. You know what Fawatim means? Plural of Fatima. So anyone in the household of the Prophet that was called Fatima, Imam Ali had responsibility to bring them to Medina. So he brought Fatima bint Asad, Fatima bint Zubair, Fatima bint Muhammad. So anyone that was called Fatima from the family of the household, it was the responsibility of Amir al-Mu'mineen, and he brought them at Masjid, you know, what we call today Masjid Quba, which was the first mosque of Islam, not the Prophet mosque. That was the first mosque. And the Prophet had waited for Amir al-Mu'mineen there. He would not move into Medina until Amir al-Mu'mineen arrived at that mosque. This is practical love and Islam into practice. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Okay. Then comes the behavioral love. We have spiritual, intellectual, behavioral. Your behavior should be in conformity with what? The teachings of Ahlul Bayt, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. What are the teachings of Ahlul Bayt? For example, someone comes, knocks the door at Imam Hussein's door, knocks the door at Imam Hussein's house, and he said, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, I had fallen into debt. I had fallen into debt. What is your debt? Yani, what is the amount of your debt? He said, in the vicinity of about 20,000-30,000. Not pounds, dirhams. Yeah, so a big amount. Then he said, okay. He goes inside, collects whatever he has in the house. Imam Hussein. Whatever he has in the house in terms of money, khums, zakat, whatever it is, you know, it comes out to at least quarter or half of the amount of the debt. Now the Imam Ali, what does he do? He doesn't open the door ajar. Yani, he doesn't open the door the whole way like he did in the first instance. And then he puts his hand behind the door, stretches it outside, and he says, take this money, pay whatever you can from your debt, and there is a letter. Take it to one of our followers. He will fulfill the rest of the debt. Right? So one of the people that works for Imam Hussein inside the house, after the man leaves, he said, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, why when he knocked the door, you opened the door for him completely, and when you brought the money, you opened the door halfway so that he could not see you? He said, because when he came the first time and I opened the door, I could see the humiliation of asking in his face. I did not want that humiliation to increase twice when I gave him the money. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Even to that extent, our imams were worried about our feelings. He doesn't want to hurt him more, because there is nothing worse than asking, right or wrong. It's very difficult to ask. Imagine then when you receive, how humiliated you will face or you will feel about yourself. The imams don't want us to be humiliated. So imagine in our own communities, I know someone that lent someone an amount of $1,000. Until he died, he kept reminding him, God damn your $1,000 if you're going to remind me about it every day. I don't want it. Right? I wish I never asked you. If the $1,000 is going to go with me to the grave for asking you for a loan, right? And you keep saying, remember the $1,000 I lent you. La hawla wa la quwwata. Is this $1,000 going to end or not? Is it going to end? Ya akhi, I've already paid you the $1,000 back. You know? You want me to pay another $1,000? Top of it as hadiyah, you know, so that you can seal your mouth against us. That is not practical love, or within the conformity of the teachings and the akhlaq of Ahlul Bayt salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Someone comes to Imam al-Baqir, behavior, it's an attitude. You must get it as an attitude. That becomes your attitude. To have good morals is an attitude, you know. Imam al-Baqir, someone comes to him, I know I'm getting out of time. Allah help you with me for the next nine nights with timing and the jama'at too, you know. So he says to Imam al-Baqir, he was not a Muslim, by the way. And he was told that this guy claims to be from the progeny of prophets. So he comes to test Imam al-Baqir. He says, Anta al-Baqara? Anta what? Al-Baqara. Anta al-ladina yadda'oon annahu al-Baqara? You are the one they call the cow. Because Baqir, right? Baqir. The Imam looks at him and says, Na'am, ana al-Baqir. He doesn't say, why are you calling me a cow? He says, Na'am, ana al-Baqir. Then he says, you are the one who is the son of the cook, referring to his mom. He says, Na'am, tilka hiya mihnatuha. Allahu Akbar. You know what he says to him? He says, yes, with all due respect, that's her profession. She's a chef. What's the big deal? Wallah, if she was now here, the mother of Al-Baqir, Hilton will pay her $3,000 for good chef. I'm not saying she would work in that. But look at the way the Imam replied. Na'am, with all due respect, that's her profession. Then he raises the bar. He says, Anta ibnu nubiyyatu sawda. Because Imam Baqir's mother was dark, black. You know, she was dark skin, right? She was from an African descent. So you know what the Imam says? He says to him, yes, she is. And let me tell you something. I'm proud that I have a mother like her. I'm proud for having a mother like her. You know, that man looks at him, he says, you are exactly as they say, from the progeny of prophets. Because no one would reply like this if you are not either a prophet or a son of a prophet. Right? This is behavioral love, according to the teachings of Ahlul Bayt. Then, jurisprudential love. Shuyani jurisprudential love. Yani, we have to follow our love of or apply our love of the imams jurisprudentially. What does jurisprudentially mean? Jurisprudentially means Sharia says that when you lend someone money, you can't what? Apply interest on it. So you must apply jurisprudence on your transaction, right? You do not all of a sudden decide to go outside the fold of Islam because now it interests you. So jurisprudentially, you're not a lover. Okay? You are putting jurisprudence aside. Fiqh, yani. You have to have a fiqhi love. Fiqh, practical love. And last but not least, aqa'idi love. What aqa'idi love means? Yani, your creed should be in conformity with that of the imams. Right? The imam says, don't put us at bar with Allah. So I don't claim, and they say they are divine. Right or wrong? Huh? Because they said, do not put us at bar with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بَلْ نَحْنُ عَبِيدُ. But we are his servants. Right? So your aqidah should be in conformity with the aqidah of Ahlul Bayt. Salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhim ajma'in. Now, do we have such examples in life that represent that kind of love who is not a ma'soom or an imam or a prophet? Right? Do we have such people? Because normally we say be like the imam, but he's a ma'soom. All right? Fine, he's a ma'soom, but he's a role model. How can I reach to a level where at least I can ascribe to their teaching, ascribe to their membership? You know, that I make them proud of myself. There is a very well-known scholar in our community. His name is Muhsin Qara'ati. This man is still alive. He had a father. He had a father. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. His son, when he reached Hawza, because he became an alim, the son of that man, the son of that Sheikh Muhsin, his father was an ordinary human being, but he had love for Hussein that is surpassing his love, you know. So his son says, I want to know, was my father's love to Hussein real? Or was it just beating his chest for him and crying for him? Was it really real? He said, I lost my father at the age of, he was 40. Yeah, and his father died at the age of 40. 6 months later, he says, I came into this world. Meaning what? Yani, when his father died, his mother was pregnant with him. Okay? So he said, I came to this world 6 months later. At the age of six, I started learning the Quran and Hadith. Now, then it occurred to me that my father had written in his wasiyah to write on his grave the following word. اذكروني عند كل مجلس عزاء للحسين. Remember my name at every majlis of Imam Hussein. I said, is it possible that this man had that much love for Imam Hussein? How is that possible? He said, while I was thinking about this, and every day it occurs to me, was my father a real lover of Imam Hussein? Then I reached the age of about 20 years old, and that was in 1965. One day I was about to enter my house, someone comes and holds me from the back and begins to cry. So I turn, I say, what is your problem? He said, you are the son of Hajj Abbas. Yani, the father of Muhsin was what? Abbas. He said, yes, I'm his son. He said, he cried to a level where he was about to pass out. This man, he's not young, he's about, you know, in his 50s or 60s by then. He says, what's your problem? He said, I'll tell you something about your dad that I have not spoken about until this day. He says, please tell me. He says, one day I decided to get married and I was poor. I brought my fiance and her mother-in-law and my mother-in-law with me. We entered the shop and I whispered in your father's ear, please give me the cheapest set of gold you have. The cheapest set of gold, because I can't afford it. He said, while I'm telling your father this, my wife goes and picks to be the most expensive set of gold. He said, I was so embarrassed that your father saw my face color changes that he packed the set of gold and he said to me, Hussein, that man's name was Hussein, I still owe you 100 tumans. During that time, 100 tumans in 65 was big money. For the building of the annexure in my house that you did and I never saw you, to pay you that amount. And the rest of the money that I owe you is the set of gold. Salamun alaikum. That Hussein says, I've never built a room for this man. I've never built a brick for this man. What is he talking about? What room? What money owed? What is he talking about? He said, we left the shop. Hussein says, we left the shop. And that was the end of the story. I got married and everything. Then I heard that your father passed away. I came home one day, and then I told my wife, do you remember this Abbas guy that we bought the gold from? He died, and I broke down in tears. She began to break down in tears. I said to her, why are you crying? She said, why are you crying? He said, I never even told her about the story of the gold. So I told her. She began to cry more. I said, what is your problem? He said, you know, that day we left his shop, he noticed that my mother's abaya was torn from the back. He couldn't see the abaya of an ordinary mother torn. I say, what would happen to you, Hajj Abbas, if you saw the abaya of Zainab on the day of Karbala? What would happen to you if you saw Zainab gathering the children in Karbala after the burning of those tents? He says, I said, yes, so what happened? He said, he's followed us discreetly until he found where we live. He knocked at the door and he handed us an envelope. And he said, this is for your daughter's wedding preparation and for you to buy a proper abaya for the wedding. He said, he did this to you? He said, yes. The man is telling the story to his son, that Mohsen Qiraati. He says, neither my wife knew my story, nor I knew her story. Then Mohsen Qiraati, that sheikh, he says, now I know how much my father really loved Imam Hussein, salawatullahi wa sallam. That when he was beating his chest, he was beating his love for money to help the underprivileged, right? When he was putting his head on his hand on his head, saying, Ya Hussein, he was caressing the head of the orphans of his city for the love of Hussein, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. This takes me to now toward to Medina, when Fatimatul Alila was bidding farewell to her father, Imam Hussein. He says, Baba, take me with you. You know what she says to him? Imam Hussein says, you are sick. I can't take you with me. She says, it doesn't matter. I'm sick. Take me at least so that I can rock the bed of Ali al-Azhar. Just take me with you. Don't leave me behind. If not to rock the bed of Ali ibn al-Azhar, at least Baba, so that I can look after your horses and feed them on the day of Karbala. He said, you are sick, I can't take you, but I promise that if I reach Karbala and all goes well, I'll send after you. Day by day she would sit and wait for this letter to come. Salamullah alayha. But the letter never came. You know what came instead? The caravan. When Bishr ibn Hazlam began to pronounce, Ya Ahla Yathrib la muqama lakum, O people of Yathrib, you should abandon Medina. You should no longer reside in the city of the Prophet, for Hussein has been killed in Karbala, and his head is displayed in Sham. Leave Medina, he says. Fatima al-Alila comes and she wants to know what is happening. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya comes. He's the disaster, brothers and sisters. And I conclude my majlis. When they come, Zainab is entering the Medina. Imam Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya is receiving the caravan of Imam Zain al-Abidin and the rest of the women. When he comes, Zainab is looking at Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya and at Fatima al-Alila. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, you know what he says to Imam? He says, tell that foreign woman to turn her face from me, because I cannot look at the face of foreign woman. يعني أجنبية, يعني نامحرم. Na mahram. He says, Imam Zain al-Abidin, my brother Muhammad, you are calling this woman na mahram. He says, yes. Who is this woman? He says, she's Zainab. Zainab. Allahu Akbar. He could not recognize his own sister. Salawatullah wa salamuhu alayha. He says, this is Zainab. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya goes to Zainab. He says, what has days done to you? What has this world done to you? Why have you turned so pale? When you left Medina, you were the princess of Al-Hashim, right? She says, oh brother, if only you saw what I saw. If only you saw a shimmer riding the chest of Hussein. Wa Husayna, wa ghariba, wa shahida. رحم الله من نادى وحسينا. May Allah have mercy on those who call out وحسينا وغريبا وشهيدا. لبيك يا حسين. Brothers and sisters, five times from the bottom of your hearts with the loudest of your voice. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. Louder. أمن أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه أمن يجيب ال... Last one with the loudest of your voices. أمن بحق محمد وآل محمد وبحرمة الفاتحة مع الصلوات. اللهم صل على محمد وآل.
Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Hussein, Ya Habibi. يا حسين يا شفيعي يا حسين يا حبيبي يا حسين يا شفيعي يا غريبي يا حسين يا حبيبي يا شفيعي يا غريبي He was Hussein and the grandson of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Hussein, mercy upon mankind Savior of all mankind Ya Habibi, Ya Hussein, Ya Shafi'i Ya Habibi, Ya Shafi'i Ya Gharibi رب کی رضا سے جس نے گردن کٹائی دین نبی کی جس نے لاج بچائی ہر گھر میں جس کا فرش ماتم بچھا ہے روتی ہے جس کے غم میں ساری خدائی یا حسین یا غریب یا ذبیح بے خطا یا حسین یا غریب یا ذبیح بے خطا یا حبیبی شفیعی یا حبیبی یا شفیعی یا غریبی مہمان کر کے اس کو کوفہ بلایا بیعت یزید کا وہ مسئلہ اٹھایا بولے حسین کبھی میں نہ کروں گا سجدے میں جس نے اپنے سر کو کٹایا یا حسین یا غریب یا ذبیح بے خطا یا حبیبی يا شفيعي يا حبيبي
سائے میں سیدا کے
یا غریبی زہرا اور حیدر جس کا جھولا جھولائے ختم مرسل بھی جس کے نازے اٹھائے خالی سوالی جس کے گھر سے نہ جائے حلم ان کی دیتا ہے وہ بن میں صدائے یا حسین یا غریب یا ذبیح بے خطا یا حسین یا غریب یا ذبیح بے خطا یا حبیبی یا شفیعی یا حبیبی یا شفیعی یا غریبی اکبر سا بیٹا دیا غازی سا بھائی لوٹی گئی ہے رن میں جس کی کمائی اب بھی گواہ ہے اس کی شام غریبا اپنے لہو سے شمع دی کی جلائی یا حسین یا غریب یا ذبیح بے خطا یا حبیبی یا شفیعی یا حبیبی یا شفیعی یا غریبی کوئی نہ دیکھا ہم نے ایسا نمازی دین نبی پہ جس نے ہر شے لٹائی پھولے بہتر دیے راہ خدا میں سب کچھ لٹا کے دیا اللہ کا راضی یا حسین یا غریب یا ذبیح بے خطا یا شفیعی یا حسین یا حبیبی یا حبیبی یا شفیعی یا غریبی جواد و میسم اس کا ماتم ہے گھر گھر روئے جنازے جس نے پیاروں کے دن بھر پھیرا گیا ہے جس کی گردن پہ خنجر چھینی گئی ہے جس کی بہنا کی چادر یا حسین یا غریب یا ذبیح بے خطا یا حبیبی یا شفیعی یا حبیبی یا شفیعی یا غریبی He was Hussein and the grandson of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Hussein, mercy upon mankind Savior of all mankind Ya Habibi Ya Shafi'i يا حبيبي يا شفيعي إن يا غريبي يا حسين الفاتحة